and other cereal species are most susceptible to yield loss around flowering, but we know that these species are also quite susceptible to frost during the stem elongation, booting, and ear emergent stages, and we also can see frost damage during grain filling. So the damage that we see in the crops is often directly related to the stage of growth that the plant was at the time of the frost event. Where damage might occur in a paddock really depends on elevation within the paddock, moisture stress of the plant, the actual temperature experienced, and a range of other factors. The definition of a frost is when the temperature drops below 2 degrees Celsius. But the most important thing about trying to identify frost damage in the paddock is getting out and having a look immediately after the frost event so you can accurately quantify the damage. Start with the high risk paddocks on the farm, so the low lying areas. And if you find frost damage in those areas, then you know to be able to look a bit further afield so you can start to move to those lower risk areas. And that will enable you to develop a bit of a prioritisation and rank paddocks for making decisions later on. Walk through the paddock every 20 to 30 paces, have a look at a plant, look at all of the tillers on that plant. And it's a really good idea to be able to put a marker in the paddock, so a steel post or something like that, that you can come back to those spots in 7 to 10 days time and have another look. If the plants haven't progressed developmentally, if they're in those stem elongation phases, that might be indicative that you need to have a bit more of a look. Another tip can be that if you walk along and identify some of the more advanced leaves in the canopy, if you give them a bit of a tug and they come away quite easily, it can also be a bit of an indicator that you might need to look a bit more at the stem. The actual damage that presents on the plant really depends on the growth stage that the plant was at the timing of the frost, and the number of frost events that plant was exposed to. So how the frost actually damages the plant during this stem elongation phases is the water actually can settle in the leaf sheath or freeze inside the stem, which affects the internodes or the developing peduncle, which can then have an influence over the developing spike. So once you've got your plant, you need to identify that primary most advanced tiller. So a little tip for that is that you run your hands up along the plant, identify that most advanced leaf, and that will be the primary tiller that we need to have a look at. Once you've identified that primary tiller, it's just a matter of running your fingers up along that stem to the top of the not last node and carefully peeling back the leaves. You can then just cut along that stem, and that will help you to peel back the leaves. That developing head, and in this case that's quite a good example of a healthy head. You can see it's quite green, whereas if you had a frost damaged head, you would find that would sort of be more bleached in colour. There could be a little bit of frizzling on the side of the head, and as that progressed more it would be quite brown and senesced. Another typical observation of frost damage can be this roughness or dehydration on the outside of the stem just above the node. Another common symptom that we see during winter is physiological yellowing on the leaves, particularly towards the leaf tip. And this can be commonly mistaken with early onset of disease, but it's actually quite often related to a frost event. So it's really important to ensure that a correct diagnosis is made. During later crop developmental stages, the frost damage presents quite differently. When we get through to that booting and early ear emergent stages, we see the damage actually affects pollen, so the pollen's aborted. So here's a nice example of some frost damage during the booting phase. You can see that the head hasn't quite emerge free of the flag leaf. The spikelets are underdeveloped and it's quite bleached and malformed. Got this next head now, you can see slightly more advanced at the time of the frost, so the head has free of the flag leaf, but we've got these underdeveloped spikelets and bleaching down the base. And then here's a good example of a head where you can see that clear ringing on the peduncle, and again you can see that underdeveloped spikelets and bleaching at the base of the head. So to have a bit of a look and see how the anthers and developing grain is forming, you can turn the head on its side and carefully peel down the outside glume and lemur to reveal the anthers inside. And here you can see on these florets, healthy green anthers. In another wheat head, same thing. So we just turn the wheat head on its side, peel back the glume and lemur, and here we can see at a yellow anther stage, so a little bit more developed. If these had been frost affected, it's really quite evident to be able to see that these anthers would be distorted in shape, sort of almost like banana shaped, and would be pale and lighter in colour. Also, the feathery stigma at the base of the grain would be less sort of fluffy and healthy looking, and the ovary at the base of that, which is clearly here white and healthy, would be brown and discoloured. Yeah, so here you can see in this head, which is a little bit more developed than the previous one, when we peel back the glume and lemur, we reveal yellow anthers in the centre of the head. And as we move from the centre, which is the most developed grain in the head, down to the base where the anthers are appearing green, which is indicative of that later development in the grain at the base of the head and also towards the tip of the head. So here's another example of a head that's slightly a bit more developed than the previous two. So you can see it's in the early stages of grain development, and it also shows that difference within the head in terms of development. So you might find plants that have been frost damaged at this stage may have damage in some parts of the grain, but not all. So for example, some of these lower florets have got some distorted banana-shaped anthers exhibiting there, so they may have been frosted, whereas some of the other developing grains look quite healthy. So in this head we can see the differences in the timing of frost as well. So you can see this more central floret has got this brown discoloration at the base of the ovary and isn't forming a head, so it's aborted the head development, so it's now a sterile floret, whereas these lower florets have actually started to develop a grain, but they haven't missed the frost because we can see that discoloration in the anthers still attached at the top of the grain, that grey sort of colour, and also we can see that sort of dimpling on the side of what should be a plump grain. You can also see that discoloration of the stigma and ovary in this one and that lack of grain development. So that's another sterile floret in this particular head. Heat and moisture stress can also display some similar symptoms to that of frost during grain development, and correct diagnosis is key. Herbicide damage will produce necrosis in the leaves, especially on the tips, and heads will also be distorted. Unlike frost damage, these symptoms appear within 4 days and anywhere in the landscape. Finally, some recommendations to minimise the impact of frost. Know your paddock's frost history, select frost-tolerant species, match sowing times and plant phenology, check paddocks as soon after a frost event as possible, tag suspected frosted plants, revisit 5 to 10 days after the event to identify frost damage.
go to the description bar below for the latest information, links and resources.